Hey, it's Andrew. I hope you're all having a merry festive season and happy holidays. Today on Trend FM, we have Carl Gold, Chief Data Scientist at Zwora, and the author of the upcoming book, Fighting Churn with Data. We talked about why Carl decided to write a book about fighting churn with data, why small companies need to determine the correct metrics in their journey to fight churn effectively, and how you can find the right metrics inside your product. We also discussed why churn and retention should revolve around providing value, why using AI and machine learning to predict churn can be ineffective, and some case study examples of how companies fight churn by focusing on the right metrics. Since it's the holiday season, we also have a special gift for this episode. We'll choose 5 lucky listeners to get early access to the first chapters of Carl's upcoming book and a copy of it once it's completed. All you have to do is share this episode on Twitter, and we'll do a random draw to choose the 5 winners. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter so we can send you a message if you're the winner. As usual, I'm excited to hear what you think of this episode, and if you have any feedback, I would love to hear from you. You can email me directly on andrew@churn.fm. Now enjoy the episode.
You need to
invest. You saw
these different...
You don't just gun for revenue in the door.
This is churn.fm. The podcast for subscription economy pros. Each week, we hear how the world's fastest growing companies are tackling churn and using retention to fuel their growth.
How do you build a habit-forming product?
We crossed over that magic threshold to negative churn.
You need to invest in customer success. It always comes down to retention and engagement.
Completely bootstrap, profitable, and growing.
Strategies, tactics, and ideas brought together to help your business thrive in the subscription economy. I'm your host, Andrew Michael, and here's today's episode.
Hey, Carl, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Andrew. Glad to be here.
It's great to have you today. For the listeners, Carl is the Chief Data Scientist at Zwora and author of the book Fighting Churn with Data. Zwora creates cloud-based software on a subscription basis that enables any company in any industry to successfully launch, manage, and transform into a subscription business. Carl is also the creator of the Subscription Economy Index and responsible for data science behind Zwora Subscriber Insights. He has a PhD from California Institute of Technology and authored publications on machine learning and neuroscience. Prior to Zwora, Carl spent most of his post-academic career on Wall Street as a quantitative analyst. So my first question for you, Carl, is what is it about churn that interests you enough to write a book about how to fight churn with data?
Well, it's a little bit of a circumstantial thing, just that I've worked on churn so much over the years. I felt like, honestly, I had made so many mistakes in the early years as a data scientist when I was trying to work on churn. And now I feel like I've actually learned how to do it properly. And I just look back and think, man, if I could have told myself 5 years ago what I should have been doing, it would have been great. So that's why I want to write a book to, you know, help other people kind of avoid the mistakes that I made. And of course, you know, do a great job with churn, because it's obviously a really pressing problem for so many, many, many companies and products nowadays.
Absolutely. And I think as well, like, a lot of people see it as a problem, but also when you see the flip side of retention, it's actually a huge opportunity. And it's probably one of your biggest like drivers for growth. So today for the listeners, we actually have a special treat. So Carl will be giving away 5 of his books after the show. And what we'd like to do is just encourage anybody listening to the episode, if you'd be interested in grabbing a copy of this book, and obviously we'll dive into details now as we get dive into the show, make sure to share this episode on Twitter, and then we'll be pulling out those tweets and having a random draw for those 5 books for those who ever share this episode within the next couple of weeks. So we'll be doing the draw in 2 weeks from this episode airing. So you mentioned like it happened to be circumstantial as well. And I know you did a PhD and was on machine learning and neuroscience. I think you did neural networks was your PhD. Is that correct?
Well, somewhat. My PhD thesis was really in a biological or biophysical modeling. So realistic modeling of neurons, not for AI, but for neuroscience. And understanding. But I was in an interdisciplinary program at Caltech where we spent a lot of time doing machine learning and brain science together.
Very interesting. So I'm pretty sure you probably read Ray Kurzweil. Is it Ray Kurzweil who wrote
How to Build the Mind? Yeah, and don't get me started on the neuroscience stuff, because I'm actually really skeptical about those kind of claims because I spent time actually studying brains and working with brain implant technology, and I would never take one of those things in my brain. Absolutely not.
Absolutely, yeah. Definitely, I think it is very futuristic.
That's a digression.
It's a totally different topic. But yeah, I was just interested, like going from that and studying sort of the brain itself, and then moving into sort of a career on Wall Street, and then like circumstantially ending up focusing in like a subscription.
Well, I don't know. Maybe I shouldn't say it's just a circumstance. It's really just the trend of the times, because I started working on a churn problem something like 5 years ago when a friend asked me, you know, about a startup. Yep. Relating to a startup that he was involved in. And then since then, you know, and coming to Zora, it's just a problem for more and more people. And so I became, you know, at Zora, obviously we have so many customers who are, you know, they all have subscription companies, and they're all very concerned about churn. So through my work here is how I got to, you know, work on so many different churn studies with different customers to give me enough knowledge to write the book. But it's really just a sign of the times, you know, that, I mean, I'm in a way the person in the right place at the right time, but it's just an overwhelming trend, but everyone's concerned about churn. But I think your point was really good about you should see it as an opportunity, because it's about the glass half full versus half empty. When you're trying to reduce churn, you're really trying to increase the customer engagement and satisfaction with your product. Yeah. So one of the main themes of the book is how you use the information that you collect about churns to find what are the most engaging aspects of your product.
Excellent. And that's what I want to dive into a little bit deeper now as well. So you've given us a slight overview what the book's about, but maybe you want to just give us a little bit more of a synopsis quick so we can dive into a few aspects of it.
Sure. Here's how I can explain it with, well, my own story. Yeah. Is that when I started doing churn analyses, I was trained as a data scientist. You know, I had a machine learning background. So when you're trained that way, you think the answer to everything is to make a predictive AI model or like a machine learning model. But I had a lot of failures in getting any traction, you know, doing that kind of analyses for companies. Because what would happen is I'd make, you know, some kind of predictive AI model, and then no one would really use it. Because what I learned is different about churn from other problems that people apply AI to, is that there's no one-size-fits-all solution to churn. So if you think about an AI problem like, you know, spam emails or something, if you detect a spam email, you know, you put it in the spam folder and you're done. But if you think someone is at risk of churn because of your, you know, your prediction, well, what do? There's a lot of different ways to reduce churn, and you need to, you know, use an appropriate one for each customer. So that, I realized, was why no one wanted a predictive model that just said who's going to churn. What they really need is to know the details about customers in a way that they can use it to drive action. So what I found people, we can talk in a minute about, you know, how people are fighting churn. I'm sure you've covered it in other podcasts. But what I found is that people in companies are really using customer metrics to segment customers for churn. They'll look at, you know, some metric of their customer and say, oh, these people are not at risk, and, you know, these people are at risk. But what I found was that a lot of times the customer metrics that companies were using were not really well designed for this purpose. As like a data science person, I would typically get the customer metrics that would be the input to the predictive model. But then I would discover, hey, those customer metrics were not that good in the first place, and no one's really using the predictive model, so maybe I should focus on making better customer metrics. So that's actually the main theme of the book, is how to use your data about churn to make really great customer metrics. A really great customer metric is going to really be associated with the value that people receive on the product. So when you segment customers by a great metric, you really are segmenting them into the groups based on how much value they receive. And then those kind of metrics can be used to make, you know, your interventions to reduce churn, you know, more data driven.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think what you're saying, it makes total sense. And it's definitely something like I've come into and been guilty of in the past is like thinking that a churn prediction model is sexy. But then when you really think about it, what are the actual use cases of it is mostly really trying to save accounts that are already at risk as opposed to, and it's very reactionary. So like you can only really act on it after the fact, as opposed to really understanding like what are those key drivers and key inputs that are going into that, that you can actually try and encourage and work towards. So you mentioned these company and customer metrics. Like, what do you advise is like a typical process then for a company really trying to get a grasp on this and really trying to understand what they should be tracking to move the needle on churn, which is a lagging metric. But how do you suggest they go about really trying to understand what these metrics should be?
Well, okay. How to go about it is really, you know, start in chapter 2 of the book and work your way through. But I'll try to, you know, put it in a nutshell. I mean, the techniques I teach assume that you're already tracking interactions with the customers. And it's not really covered by the book because that's a technology. You know, you can buy that from many different companies, you know, things that will allow you to track. And I want to also clarify that when I say tracking, I'm talking about usage of the product, not, you know, stalking people on the internet, right?
Yes.
So everything I talk about does not involve personal information at all. It only involves watching and measuring. It's really measuring your own product, right? How many people are coming to each page if it's a website? How many people are using each feature? If it's a SaaS tool, or how many people are watching each video, or, you know, if you're a streaming video service. And so those are your basic events that you should be tracking. And in that case, the most important events for tracking, it's different for every company because it always has to be the events that are most closely associated with getting value. And that's different on every product. I mean, there are some general statements you can make. For example, I mean, logins are almost always one of the weakest measures of engagement because, well, if someone logs in, they haven't accomplished anything, right? You really want to track what do people actually accomplish on your product. And if it's, you know, if your product is for making documents, you might track document creation. If it's for, say, streaming media, you get into this thing, well, watching a video is like a good event to track, but even better would be completing a video because that means the person actually, you know, liked it. And then if you track likes, then tracking likes of videos would be even better. So all those different events and interactions you can track form the foundation for what comes after. Does that part make sense so far?
Absolutely. I think it's something we
kind of answer the question.
Yep, it definitely does. I think like early on we interviewed Heidi Gibson from GoDaddy, and I love what you touched on now is really about measuring value. And I think in some cases it's really obvious and really easy to do. You know, if somebody is coming to YouTube, for example, to watch a video, like if they've watched the video, the value is clear there. For other startups though, it's not as clear cut as well. I think like for example, a website builder like GoDaddy itself is one thing. Yes, it's you want to build a website so that you can say, okay, once you built the website, that's just achieved part of the goal. But really, you're not building a website to have a website. You're building a website to drive sales or to do close bookings. And really, it's sort of the end goal and the end value. And the closer you can get to measuring and tracking the actual value that your customers receive from your product, obviously the most powerful it's going to be in terms of a predictor of if people are going to stick around or not.
Yeah, absolutely. So some products, it's going to be easier than others. So it's a good example, you know, the website builder, you know, GoDaddy or any company like that, you know, creating a website is one thing and you would want to track that. But then also great metrics for customer churn would also be the website traffic, you know, how many people come. And if you can even measure transactions, you know, then that would be the holy grail. But not every system is going to allow you to directly measure the value that customers receive that way.
Yeah.
But with the, you know, using the techniques of analysis, basically what I show you is you can turn almost any measure of customer behavior into a measure of customer health, simply because what you almost always find is that the more customers, you know, do different behaviors, you'll see a relationship to churn that usually plateaus. So it's pretty easy to see what the healthy state is. So almost any metric can become an indicator of customer health. But then you have to remember, okay, is this metric really directly causing engagement, or is it just correlated with engagement? So, I mean, this is the question of correlation versus causation is well known. There's no escaping it.
Yeah.
But you can work around it is the thing. I mean, that the book, I really don't dwell on that at all, because you can use the important thing in metrics for churn. I mean, here are the important things that you need, what I think, to make a customer metric really great. It should be really related to retention and churn, and you should be able to see it in your data pretty easily using the techniques in the book. A great customer metric, it also needs to allow targeted interventions by the people who are trying to reduce churn. So that it should allow people to, you know, segment customers into healthy and unhealthy groups for the purpose of interventions. The metrics have to be easy to understand, because generally it's not going to be a data scientist or, you know, a technical person trying to reduce churn. It's people in marketing and customer support. We'll say more about that in a minute. Well, that's actually the last point actually about, you know, good customer metrics or great customer metrics is if more than one department can use it. So, for example, actually a good example is, you know, churn forecasting or churn prediction. The risk of churn is a good metric, but it's really only appropriate, I think, for one department, which is like a customer success function.
Yeah.
Because they're the ones who are going to, you know, reach out to a customer who's in trouble. So naturally, they could use a metric of, you know, who's in trouble.
Yeah.
But customer metrics aren't, the type of interventions I advocate aren't just those kind of one-on-one interventions. I mean, it doesn't have to be reactive. It could be like, you know, it is kind of proactive if you reach out to them. But the thing is, before even the customer, you should think about the product, because the best way, I think, and I know you've said similar things on your other podcasts, but the best way to reduce churn is to have a better product or, a great product.
Yeah.
And you can use the customer metrics that I'm talking about to really figure out in a data-driven way, you know, what are your best features and who's using them, who's not using them. So then you can make look-alike features, or you might just want to, if you figure out one feature is really driving engagement, you might want to make it more prominent, you know, make it easier to find if it's not already easy to find. But then when it comes to people who aren't using your great features, that's where your marketing department should get involved. And they should be sending out occasionally campaigns to make sure that people know about all your great features. So I'm talking about campaigns to your customers, not for sales. So this is marketing working on, you know, like a customer success project. Yeah. But when you send the campaign to get people using the great features, you don't just want to spam everyone who has a high churn risk. You really want to target the people who aren't using the feature. So that's the churn risk forecast. It's not usable really by the other departments. It's only usable in customer success, which is still good. You know, so I'm not completely trashing it. I'm just saying a really great customer metric, more than one department, you know, would see a use for it. So
yeah, and that definitely makes a lot of sense. I think there was, I was alluding to at the beginning when I mentioned in terms of the churn model, the team that's most useful is going to be the customer success, because they can then go in and try and save the accounts.
What would be like sort of the alternating view then on that and would be a metric that would potentially be scaled across the team? Would you think about looking potentially like a retention prediction model? Is that something you've looked into, or do you find that it comes to the same sort of conclusion?
No, it really comes down, I think, to, you know, good or great metrics. And if you just take a simple metric, like let's say your product, is for, you know, editing documents or something like that, or different kinds of documents. I don't know. I'm just making up an example off the cuff. If you have just a metric of, you know, how many documents per month a customer is making, like in different types, then once you do the analysis that I show in the book, you can easily see what's a healthy level for each type of document. Maybe it's like 20 documents a month is where customers look healthy on that metric. Well, so then you know what you're driving to for the marketing and engagement campaigns. And also the customer success team has a clear goal too. Because if you tell the customer success team, oh, these accounts are at risk of churn, right? Well, then they're like, okay, what do I do for these accounts? So you're just back to the same question. You need metrics with a known kind of level of health, a known, you know, point, a known target for, I need to come up with a better term for this, but I think you get where I'm going.
For sure.
So usually, the churn risk forecast can be good, but it's always in combination with other things that will tell you how to act with that particular customer. Or what group, or not, well, you'll segment the customers. You'll almost never do anything, you know, one by one, but you'll segment the customers in a group that could benefit from a certain kind of treatment. You know, maybe a class, you know, it could be like, you know, some kind of webinar on how to use the product better.
Yeah.
You know,
I think as well, like the thing with the churn prediction side of things is it really looks to try and find and identify the behaviors of users that are about to churn or that are at risk of churning, as opposed to, again, like going back to the alternate view of really focusing on what are the actions and key actions that users are taking that are retaining and sticking around. Because when you think about sort of like churn as an output metric, and it's definitely a lagging indicator, and right. Like actions you take today could only be seen maybe 6-12 months from now. Like it's really about understanding what are those input metrics. And I think that's what you're alluding to in terms of like the value side of things with figuring out like 20 documents and pushing towards that.
Well, there's an important trick with that actually that I teach in the book, and I'll explain it as best I can in the podcast. You mentioned like, you know, churn is a lagging indicator. So one of the key techniques I advocate and teach in the book is that you actually pair observation of churn with observation of the customer from a time before the actual churn took place. Because typically, if you think about it, if you look at a customer like the day before they cancel, their behavior has already changed. Right? They might have stopped using many features and maybe only using a few features that are relevant right before they quit. Yeah. So if you have a pattern like that, it would actually make it easy to predict who is going to churn on the day before they quit, but by then it's too late. So the trick is actually when you do these analyses is to pair the observation of the churn with metrics from a time significantly before the churn. Well, and the time before depends on the product type. If it's a monthly product, you know, month to month, then you would probably look at, you know, the metrics right after the last renewal, or maybe 1 week after their last payment and 3 weeks or 4 weeks before their next payment. And then you would observe customers, you know, 3 weeks out and then look 3 weeks later who actually churns. And that helps to control for that, you know, lagging nature of the churn. For a product with annual subscriptions, like a SaaS product for businesses, and this is how we do it at Zora, you look at the customers typically around 3 months before the renewal. And that's the metrics that you're looking at. So hopefully that 3 months before renewal is a time when the customers haven't made up their mind yet. They're still, you know, evaluating before their next renewal. Yeah. And that's a technique. It's really kind of a trick, but I mean, just a, you know, a tech technique to make your analysis more about the leading indicators of churn. Although you can never perfectly, you know, control for that problem.
Interesting. So what you're saying then, just so I get to understand this clearly. So if we take the scenario B2B SaaS and you mostly yearly plans, you're taking a look at the yearly, the behavior that they show 3 months before that renewal is about to happen. And then are you looking at those that churned and those that didn't and comparing the differences between the two?
Yeah, I mean, that's the essence of the method. Look a good time out from the renewal. You got to include both customers that renewed and those that didn't, so that you're comparing them. And I mean, of course, I mean, this is a book on data science and programming methods. You're not in the book. I'm not going to tell you to like compare the customers one by one. You group them into cohorts and compare the cohorts. But again, it's all cohorts of people who are in an annual renewal case. It's all cohorts that were 3 months from their renewal at the time that you measured them.
Very interesting. And would you recommend like sort of focusing on this sort of an analysis as opposed to really looking at customers who were still with us in the second year and seeing what behavior they had versus customers that weren't? Like, what would be, in your opinion, like the difference between the two views of one sort of just before churning and one actually after churn has occurred, but also focusing really on the behaviors of those that are still around?
Yeah, well, you can do different, I mean, additional analyses. For example, you know, you could do one thing only on year one customers and one thing only on year two customers. I usually don't actually do that. I do include the length of time that someone has been a customer as, you know, another metric that you can apply this thinking to. And what you'll typically see, everyone knows this, is that churn falls over time. Well, for most companies, I should say, churn decreases over time. And it's not always bad if it doesn't, but that's another story. So, I mean, the length of time they've been a customer can be a separate dimension of this kind of, you know, analytic process. And also, yeah, you can divide customers into different groups, but I usually don't do it because, honestly, I find that the behaviors itself are the most telling thing. And if you have a customer who's, you know, 6 months in versus 18 months in, if their behaviors are the same in terms of, you know, the value they're getting from the product, it usually doesn't make that much difference that one is, you know, 1 year in versus 2 year in. Of course, the one problem with, you know, looking at the relationship between how long they've been a customer and churn is it's not particularly actionable in the sense that you can't make someone be a longer term customer other than by waiting and having them not churn, right?
Yeah.
It is useful. You might see peaks in churn risk. Like you might, like for a monthly product even, you might see that risk dips in the first year and peaks around 1 year from sign up. And that can be actionable information that, you know, you should be reaching out to people, you know, right before their 1 year anniversary, maybe get them in a webinar or a training or anything, you know. But the relationship between the length of time and churn is something that people obsess over from a financial perspective, because the profile of churn versus, you know, subscriber lifetime is, it's important to understand for finance, but it's not actually as helpful for reducing churn, in my opinion.
Yeah. So that makes a lot of sense, I think, from the yearly perspective. When you think about sort of the monthly, and the reason I'm thinking, because we're probably saying the same thing, but just in slightly different ways, is like when you think about sort of monthly SaaS business and you have a customer who's been paying you for like 9 consecutive months, which is typically higher than your LTV or your current sort of average lifespan. Would looking at their behaviors, so this is what I was talking about in terms of like having somebody who's in quote unquote a successful customer because they've stuck around for a long time and they still continue to pay and use your service.
you would still say, okay, it's much better just to focus on the actual behaviors that users show to churn, as opposed to looking at like what successful customers look like as well? Or would you want to be doing both?
I'm also an advocate of simplicity in churn analysis.
Yeah.
In the sense that, I mean, the most important thing for most customers is just to make metrics, get great metrics for your customers, and get them in front of the churn fighters, which are like the customer success, the marketers, the product creators, right? They're the ones who are going to reduce churn. They yep. need good information, which is usually just, you know, the customer metrics. And when you try to get into more advanced stuff like, oh, the first year customers versus the second year customers, they might not end up using it. I mean, it's one of those things where, yeah, if you're Netflix, you should definitely do a really detailed analysis of everyone every year, because you also have a data science team of 1,000 people, right? But if you're a smaller company and you're the only data person, just focus on getting great customer metrics and don't worry about hair splitting between first year, second year. You know, get the metrics in the hands of the churn fighters, make sure they know what's a healthy level for those metrics, which isn't hard to do. And then let them do what they're gonna do, because you know, the marketers and the customer success people, they all operate with different constraints, you know, and different opportunities depending on the kind of product you're on. So it's hard to generalize about that.
I think for me, the thing that just sticks in my brain is like, this is because it's sort of like, again, going back to thing, focusing on the problem as opposed to the solution. So like when you're focusing on sort of that churn event and trying to figure out how to avoid it, as opposed to focusing on a retained state and how to encourage it. So like, that's why for me,
exactly,
describing is like a little bit counterintuitive in my mind, at least, but I'm slowly coming around.
My approach definitely is to focus on the engaged state, you know, and look at, you know, what do people look like in that state and try to make customers like that.
Okay. So that makes sense. But then maybe let's talk about a real life example now, and it's Wara. So maybe like if you can be a little bit specific in terms of the metrics that you, the good customer metrics that you've come up with for the team, and how the different teams are using those metrics.
Sure. Probably better not Zora, but I can talk about the case studies that are in my book. There's three companies that are agreed to be case studies in the book. One is named Broadly, and it's a SaaS product for managing a business's online presence. Another one is called Clipfolio, and Clipfolio is a dashboarding tool for metrics. I definitely recommend you check out Broadly and Clipfolio. And a third company is Versature. They're a telco in Canada, telecommunications over the internet. So let's just take one of those examples, you know, like say the Clipfolio. It's a dashboarding tool. So your basic metrics there are going to be just how many dashboards, you know, are they looking at? How many dashboards do they have? But the truth is, those are only kind of basic metrics, and simple counts of how much people use of things only go so far, because you end up with a problem with a company like Clipfolio or any SaaS product that you have bigger and smaller customers.
Yeah.
So you have big customers who have, you know, 1,000 employees and they buy 50 seats, and they are going to look at a lot of dashboards. And then you have small customers that have, you know, 5 employees and they buy 2 seats. So, you know, selling by the seat. And so just looking at the number of dashboards or the number of views is limited, because you can't tell the difference between, you know, a small company that looks at a lot of dashboards and a big company that's not using it. So then you get into more advanced metrics. And a good example there is license utilization. So that's what you get when you take the number of active users and divide it by the number of seats sold. And that's an even better metric, because, you know, it applies across these different sizes of companies.
Yeah.
So to make, you know, more examples like that, a good metric and an even better metric, Well, for example, for the telco, Versature in the book, you see the more calls customers make, the less they churn, right?
Yep.
That makes sense. Now, let me tell you something surprising, or here, I'll ask you this one first. If customers pay more in terms of like their monthly fees, do you think they churn less or churn more?
Typically, I would say churn less.
Yes, it's almost always customers who pay more churn less.
Yeah.
And that makes sense, especially if you think about it in the SaaS context, where, you know, a B2B customer, if they're paying more, it means they're a bigger customer. They have 100 employees instead of, you know, 5. And a bigger customer, a bigger company is going to churn less, well, for several reasons. One, they're less at risk of going out of business. And two, they're going to be more invested, you know, in the product that they bought because they're paying more, they had to train more people.
Process, security, all sorts of things to get things approved. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So once you get a big customer, they're going to churn less. But so that makes a problem with interpreting pricing. So here's where great customer metrics come into pricing. Instead of looking at just the price customers pay in recurring revenue, look at the unit price they pay. So for Versature, that metric would be the cost per call. And that's not a true unit price because the product isn't sold by the call. You know, it's sold with a monthly recurring fee. But you can still calculate the price per call that customers make in that scenario. And there you actually see a really great metric and a strong relationship to churn, where the higher the cost per call, the higher the churn, period. So that's where you actually see the true impact of your pricing. And that's really powerful because, I mean, that a metric like if you look at, you know, a unit cost metric and see what's the healthy level and what's the not healthy level, it's really powerful across all levels of your customers. And it's also really great information for your pricing. We didn't even talk about right sizing pricing, but that's a way to reduce churn also.
Yeah.
I advise people against discounts for reducing churn. They generally don't work. You use discounts to get people to sign up. And if you're giving out discounts to reduce churn, you're actually, really, you're undermining your pricing.
And so, your product and your brand. Like,
yeah. But there is such a thing as if you have like a good, better, best pricing structure, like a basic, standard, and premium plan, it does absolutely make sense to get people on the right plan. So it's not giving someone a discount if you downgrade them from, you know, standard to basic. It is revenue churn, so it's still a form of churn, but it's a lesser form of churn. But anyway, that a unit cost metric is actually, if there's one thing, if you're listening to this podcast and you're like, what's one takeaway that I can apply to my business? Calculate a metric which is like a unit cost, and it's almost always a very powerful metric for understanding engagement. And I think people really think this way because, like, you know, when I'm thinking, evaluating my Netflix subscription, I'm really thinking, oh, how many episodes or movies did I watch last month? And if it's like one, I'm like, damn, that was an expensive movie. But yeah. If it's 50, I'm like, wow, I'm getting a great deal from Netflix, right?
For sure.
So people really think that way. And I think, I mean, I'm not a psychologist really, even though I studied neuroscience, but... yeah. So definitely unit cost metrics. Again, that's like taking the metrics to the next level. It's not a basic metric of usage or what they paid, but it's a, you know, a ratio of what they pay to what they use.
Yep.
That's really powerful for segmenting, and it can drive action, you know, in multiple parts of the company from understanding that one metric.
Very cool. I love both examples though, as well as sort of like proxies. And you mentioned the points as well, like some businesses have large companies and they have small companies using their service. And it's not always easy to distinguish. And specifically, more specifically, when we think about privacy and not having to be able to enrich data and pull in from different sources. I really love the way that you sort of be able to figure out, like, are people getting value out of the service and using the idea of licensing versus utilization, or in this case as well, like sort of the cost per call. I think it's really, really insightful.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, I love it too. It's turned into a really interesting area. Honestly, I had no idea when I first started thinking about churn that I'd, over the years, you know, find so many interesting angles on it.
Absolutely. Yeah, because I think it's like, I'm also thinking about in the context, I currently lead the business intelligence team at Hotjar. And for us as well, like we're an all-in-one solution. So we have analytics and feedback tools, and we do things like heat maps, session recordings, like polls, surveys, and so forth. And yet, one, it's not always easy to distinguish behavior, like you say, between like a large and small company when you're just looking at the data and the numbers without having that reference point. And then two, as well, is like, how do you establish, like, are these companies actually receiving the value that they're looking for you? And like, can they justify again sort of that price? So this is definitely something I'll take back to the team to sort of try and see which areas we can maybe make our metrics more, how can you say, like stringent and focused. So next question I want to ask is like, typically, I ask this question to everyone on the show, and I want to hear your input as well. So if you had to start a new job at a new company, and you arrive and you see turnover retention is not great, and the CEO has given you the job to try and help turn things around for the company, and he's given you 90 days to try and sort of show some results for the company, what would be your process? Where would you start? And what would be one or two of the first things that you would action?
Well, honestly, I don't know if this will be the best advertisement for the techniques in my book, because the first thing I would do is just look at the backlog of all the things that, you know, you're trying to do. So, and when you look at the backlog for a typical product, you might find things like, oh, the Android version doesn't work, you know? And you have to make sure there's no real bombs in your product that are, you know, just torpedoing it. I mean, the stuff about great customer metrics and making sure everyone's getting value, it assumes that you don't have any really obvious fails going on, but most companies will know about these from QA and, you know, customer feedback and tickets, and they just won't have done something yet. So, because really always the best way to reduce churn is a great product. And if you have a situation where, like, you know, one of your mobile versions doesn't work or something, or, you know, you gotta deal with that before you worry about, I mean, no one's going to get value if they can't even get the app installed, right?
Absolutely.
So, and first 90 days, that's pretty tough to say to actually make a change in churn, because it really depends on, you know, what are those product gaps. Now, if you don't have major product gaps, and you have a significant churn, and you have a churn problem, then it probably has to do with competition, and that's where you need to really, then you really do need to get into the metrics. And I mean, if I found in, say, my first month at this job that there were no serious product gaps or things that were just like obvious, you know, killers, then I would, you know, turn to the techniques I advise in the book, which is, you know, look at what events are being tracked, you know, make sure they're suitable, make customer metrics from those events, and, you know, see what you learn. And then you can start planning the interventions. It could be, you know, product improvements or changes in the layout, or it could be, you know, things like engagement campaigns. So in that scenario, you might be able to get some results in the first 90 days. If you spend your first 30 days making sure there's no product gaps, your second 30 days, doing all the data analysis, and maybe in the last month of your 90 days, you could start doing some targeted campaigns to drive some more engagement.
Very cool.
So that would be my 90 day plan.
Your 90 day plan. Yeah. So it's obviously, it's not an easy question to answer as well, not having an understanding of where the company is at and what sort of product you're dealing with. And like you say, like churn itself is such a nuanced problem. You can't build a model for it because it's not as easy as, say, a spam model that applies to any company in every situation. So definitely multifaceted. So I see we're running up on time. One last question for you. And like, what is one thing that you wish more companies would look at when it comes to churn and retention?
I don't know if there's, it's hard to say just one thing, but I mean, the overall theme is definitely to look at it as not, you know, reducing the churn, but increasing the engagement and value. And so if you wanted to say one thing, I guess I'd go back to my, you know, unit cost metric, because that's really going to separate, you know, who's finding the value and who's not. For any product with a price, you know, that is. So, I mean, all in general, churn fighting techniques apply to free products too. You don't have to have a subscription. But if you are on a recurring payment plan, then definitely, I mean, the unit cost metric as a way to really see, you know, who's getting value.
Absolutely. And I think even on free products, that you're still paying a price and you're paying it with your time typically. So, or your
eyes. Yeah, exactly.
Cool. So very, very good call. I really, really appreciate having you on the show today. And once again, for the listeners, Carl is going to be giving away 5 copies for his book, Fighting Churn with Data. So you'll hear some of the techniques he discussed today and a lot more as well with that. So once again, make sure to share this episode on Twitter and we'll be sure to grab your name and add it to the draw, which will be announced 2 weeks from today's air date. And 5 lucky people will get a copy of his book. Carl, really, really appreciate having you on the show. Thanks so much for joining today. Maybe you want to just leave us with final thoughts and how the listeners can keep up to date with your work.
Well, one thing I just want to point out, so no one, you know, feels like they've been misled, is the book is not actually complete. There's currently 4 chapters in an ebook. And if you do get one of the ebooks, you'll get the 4 chapters that are available now. The 5th is coming out soon. And then you'll get around 1 chapter a month in an ebook. And then the book will be, the hard copies will come out. We're targeting June of next year. But the book is about 80% written at this point. But, you know, publishing, you know, hard copies takes a lot longer than making the ebooks. And also, parting thoughts, I do have a blog website. It's just fightchurnwithdata.com. And that's where there's, you know, there's like a video of a conference talk I gave and some blog posts and, you know, different resources that I found. In fact, there will be a link to this podcast by the time you look at it. So yeah. Fightchurnwithdata.com is the website to follow up.
Excellent. And sorry, it's good that you pointed it out. I've always found it very interesting as well. So it's Manning Publications, and you're able to launch a book early, get some feedback from like sort of your beta readers to some extent. But again, the content itself, like Carl said, is 80% there. And you will at the end as well have access to that book. So thank you so much again for joining. And thanks for sharing with the listeners. Wish you the best of luck now in the completion of the book and your endeavors going forward.
All right. Thanks, Andrew.
Thanks, Carl. Cheers.
And that's a wrap for the show today with me, Andrew Michael. I really hope you enjoyed it and you're able to pull out something valuable for your business. To keep up to date with churn.fm and be notified about new episodes, blog posts, and more, subscribe to our mailing list by visiting churn.fm. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our show on iTunes, Google Play, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. If you have any feedback, good or bad, I would love to hear from you. And you can provide your blunt, direct feedback by sending it to andrew@churn.fm. Lastly, but most importantly, if you enjoyed this episode, please share it and leave a review, as it really helps get the word out and grow the community. Thanks again for listening. See you again next week.